Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvanni. I am happy to meet you again through the video lecture series on the subject Engineering Thermodynamics. And this is module number 3, Second Law of Thermodynamics. This is the first lecture on the Second Law of Thermodynamics. Before we enter into the lecture, we recap from the previous topic what we discussed earlier. In the earlier lectures, we discussed the thermodynamic properties, pressure, volume, temperature, internal energy, enthalpy, all the properties we have discussed. We defined the second zeroth law of thermodynamics, and based on the zeroth law of thermodynamics, we identify a property called temperature, and we studied about the first law of thermodynamics. We applied the first law of thermodynamics to open system and the closed system, and we solved a few problems on the applications. First law of thermodynamics applications. And here in the second law of thermodynamics, the topic for this discussion, lecture number 301, limitations of first law of thermodynamics, cyclic heat engine, energy reservoir, second law of thermodynamics, the statements of second law of thermodynamics, Kelvin-Planck statement and Clausius statement, and we discuss about the refrigerator and the heat pump. The learning outcome for the lecture. At the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain the limitations of first law of thermodynamics. The student will be able to state the second law of thermodynamics, both the Kelvin-Planck and the Clausius statements, and the student will be able to distinguish between heat engine, refrigerator and the heat pump, and the student will be able to describe the energy reservoir. And first we take the limitations of first law of thermodynamics. First law of thermodynamics, it is obtained by applying energy conservation principle. The net heat transfer equal to net work transfer in a cyclic process. So, in a cyclic process, the net heat transfer is equal to net work transfer, or simplified version of first law of thermodynamics, heat and work are mutually convertible. So, what do you mean by heat and work are mutually convertible? If you supply heat energy to the system, that will be converted into work energy. When you supply work energy to the system, that will be converted into heat energy. So, the heat and work are mutually convertible. That is what the first law of thermodynamics. And it is not giving. The first law of thermodynamics is not very clear. There are some problem with the first law of thermodynamics. First, we will see. The first law of thermodynamics establishes equivalence between the quantity of heat used and the mechanical work. So, the heat and work are equal. So, when you supply 10 kilojoules of heat to the system, it will produce 10 kilojoules of work from the system. That is what the first law of thermodynamics states. So, heat and work are mutually convertible, but does not specify the condition under which the conversion of heat into work is possible. What is the condition for equivalence of heat and work? So, the condition is not specified by the first law of thermodynamics, or the direction in which heat transfer takes place. So, direction may be heat supplied to the system, heat rejected from the system. So, heat transfer, in general heat transfer. So, the direction in which heat transfer takes place, that is also not mentioned by the first law of thermodynamics. First law of thermodynamics discusses the exchange of energy from one form to another form. So, it is only heat and work. So, heat is we use only two terms on energy in the thermodynamics. One is heat, another one is work. So, first law of thermodynamics states that when you supply heat to the system, work is produced. Or when you supply work to the system, heat is produced. That is what the first law of thermodynamics. So, it does not describe the feasibility of the process. So, when you supply heat energy, whether this is completely convertible into work, or whether when you supply work energy, whether this is completely convertible into heat. Is it possible? that is not clearly mentioned by the first law of thermodynamics. For example, you take the braking system of an automobile. Everybody, today we have a two-wheeler or we drive the four-wheeler, we apply brake. So, the vehicle is running. When you apply brake, what will happen? The vehicle is stopped. The kinetic energy of the vehicle is stopped. So, applying brake is a mechanical work input to the system. When you apply the mechanical work input to the system, the vehicle is stopped. And because of the rubbing action of the brake shoe on the drum, heat is generated. So, the amount of work given is used to stop the vehicle, and because of that, because of the friction, there is some amount of heat energy is generated, and the heat energy is dissipated to the atmosphere. In any braking system, either the cycle or two-wheeler or four-wheeler, any automobile braking system, when you apply the brake, a small amount of heat is generated that is being dissipated to the atmosphere. Now, you imagine whether the reverse of the process is possible. When you heat the brake, so what we said, the heat is given to the atmosphere. Now, we give back the heat. When you heat the brake, whether the vehicle will run? No, that is not possible. So, that is what the problem. So, the work is converted into heat, but when you give the heat back to the braking system, the vehicle will not run. That is what the direction, that is what mentioning the direction. So, that is why the first law of thermodynamics, it is not mentioning the direction in which the energy transfer is taking place. All this spontaneous process in nature is in one direction. So, they are not equal direction. For example, heat transfer occurs from high temperature to source to a low temperature. Water always flow downwards. Time always flow in the forward direction. These are all these spontaneous processes or natural processes. They are occurring in one direction. The reverse is not possible. Heat cannot flow from low temperature to high temperature. Heat always flow from high temperature to low temperature naturally. Water always flow from the upward towards the downward direction, from higher elevation to the lower elevation naturally. Time always flow in the forward direction, right? So, in nature, this is what happening, right? And the spontaneity is due to the finite driving force. So, for heat transfer, we require a driving potential. For water flow, we require a driving potential. So, the driving potential is the spontaneity of the process is given by the driving potential. So, these are all the driving potential. Temperature gradient causes the heat transfer. Gradient is the change in temperature with respect to time. Gradient means change in a particular parameter with respect to time, with respect to another parameter. So, temperature gradient causes the heat transfer. Concentration gradient causes the mass transfer. Electric potential gradient causes the current flow. Pressure difference causes the fluid flow. So, these are all the gradients. So, which causes the driving, which is the driving potential for the natural process. And you look at this diagram. In the first diagram, we are giving some amount of work input to the system that causes to produce some amount of heat energy. In the second diagram, we supply the heat energy and the system is producing work. So, here work is given, heat is produced. And here heat is given, work is produced. But look at the statement below. When the work is given, heat is produced. So, the amount of work is completely convertible into heat. In a natural process, the amount of work is completely convertible into work. But here you look at the diagram here. Heat is given, work is produced. But the amount of heat given is greater than amount of the work done. So, work done by the system is less than the amount of heat given to the system. So, here it is not following the first law of thermodynamics. So, here it is okay. Work is given, heat is produced. But here it is not. So, based on your first law of thermodynamics, the net amount of work transfer equal to net amount of heat transfer. But it is violating. So, something is there in between. So, that is what we are going to discuss in the second law of thermodynamics. So that is why work can be completely convertible into heat. For example, immersion water heater. So in the immersion water heater, use the water heater for heating the water. So we give current to the heater. We give current to the heater, the electrical resistance. So the current given to the heater is a kind of work input, and it is producing, the heater is producing heat energy. So whatever the work given, 1 watt or 2 watt to the heater, that is completely converted into heat energy. But heat is not completely convertible into work. For example, diesel engine, petrol engine, steam engine, any heat engine, the amount of work produced by the heat engine is less than the amount of heat supply. So that is why work is called as high grade energy and heat is called as low grade energy. But in general, the statement is the complete conversion of low grade energy into high grade energy in a cycle is impossible. So the complete conversion of high grade energy low grade energy is not possible. So the cycle, so before we go for the next second law of thermodynamics, we take define the heat engine cycle, cyclic heat engine. The closed, so there are two types of cyclic heat engine. One is closed system heat engine cycle, another one is open system heat engine cycle. First we take the closed system heat engine cycle. So we have a piston reciprocating piston cylinder arrangement. The piston is reciprocating back and forth. So when this piston is reciprocating from the right side to the left side, it is compression. When the piston is reciprocating moving from the left side to the right side, there is expansion. So during the compression, we are giving the work. During the expansion, work is produced by the system. And here we supply the heat energy. Q1 is the amount of heat energy supplied and Q2 is the amount of heat energy rejected. So the system, the heat engine cycle, why it is called as closed system? The mass of the system, mass inside the piston cylinder arrangement, that remains constant. That is why it is called as closed system. So the various processes, 4 successive processes, they are compression, work is done on the system. Then heat addition, heat is supplied to the system. Then expansion, work is done by the system. Then heat rejection, heat is rejected from the system. So there are 4 processes, 1 work input, 1 heat input, 1 work output, and 1 heat output, heat rejection. So the net heat transfer equal to Q1 minus Q2. So Q1 is the amount of heat supplied, Q2 is the amount of heat rejected. Net work done equal to WE minus WC. So WE is the work done during the expansion process, WC equal to work done during the compression process. So from the first law of thermodynamics, in a cyclic process, net heat transfer is equal to net work transfer. So Q net equal to W net. So the Q1 minus Q2 equal to WE minus WC. So efficiency of the heat engine cycle is net work output of the cycle divided by heat input to the cycle. So this equation you have to remember. So throughout your mechanical engineering course, you will be using this equation. Efficiency of any heat engine cycle, efficiency of any heat engine. So efficiency equal to net work output divided by the heat supply. So net work output equal to WE minus WC, heat supply equal to Q1. And from the statement here, Q1 minus Q2 equal to WE minus WC. So Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1, or efficiency equal to, rearranging the terms, 1 minus Q2 by Q1. This is what the efficiency of the heat engine cycle. So efficiency, the term efficiency of the heat engine is very important. And we will be using it for all the courses in future. So for any IC engine, gas turbine, all the courses we will be using this. So efficiency equal to net work done divided by heat supply, or efficiency equal to 1 minus heat rejected divided by the heat supply. So Q2 is the heat rejected and Q1 is the heat supply. And next cycle, open system heat engine cycle. So this is, look at this. So this is open system because the mass is flowing continuously, so within the system, right? Mass is flowing through various devices. So it is a steam power plant. So the furnace, using the furnace, we produce heat energy and the heat is given to the boiler. So in the boiler, the water is converted into water vapor. So H2O water is entering here using the heat energy, water vapor is produced, and this water vapor goes to the turbine. So here in the turbine, the water vapor is expanded and produced. It is producing work. The work is WT, turbine work, and after expansion, it goes to the condenser where the heat is removed. The amount of heat is removed using the sea water, river, or atmosphere. After a removal of heat energy, it becomes condensed. I mean, it is condensed and becomes liquid. And using the pump, we are supplying work in the pump. Using the pump, the work, the fluid is again circulated to the boiler. So boiler, turbine. So boiler, heat is supplied to the water. Turbine, work is produced by the gases. And the condenser, heat is rejected from the fluid. And the pump, work is given to the fluid. So again, here again, the four processes: heat supply, work done by the fluid, and heat rejection, and work input to the system. Work heat supplied to the system, work output of the system, heat rejected from the system, and work input to the system. So in this, the net heat transfer equal to net work transfer. Again, first law of thermodynamics says that net heat transfer equal to net work transfer. So Q1 minus Q2 equal to WT minus WP. And the efficiency equal to net work divided by the heat supplied equal to WT minus WP divided by Q1, which is also equal to Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1, and the efficiency equal to 1 minus Q2 by Q1, that is 1 minus heat rejected minus divided by heat supplied. So what we observe from the two derivations, whether this is open system or the closed system heat engine cycle, the efficiency remains the same. So efficiency equal to 1 minus Q2 by Q1, or net work done divided by the heat supply. So this you have to remember, and we will be solving problem using this relationship. And these equations are very much important for any mechanical engineering student. And we discussed the energy reservoir. So reservoir, what do you mean by a reservoir? It is a place where we store abundant energy is available, abundant quantity of certain thing available is called as reservoir. And energy reservoir is the body which is store energy. So thermal energy reservoir is defined as a large body of infinite heat capacity, which is capable of absorbing or rejecting an unlimited quantity of heat without appreciable change in the atmosphere. What is the example for the reservoir? Atmospheric air is a reservoir. What do you mean by atmospheric air? We are continuously giving heat energy by pollution, automobile pollution, from various sources. The heat is continuously given to the atmosphere. But look at the atmospheric temperature. It is almost constant. So the temperature remains constant. Now, there is no appreciable change in the temperature. So energy reservoir is a body, large body of infinite capacity, which is capable of absorbing or rejecting an unlimited quantity of heat without appreciable change in the temperature. The reservoir, thermal energy reservoir, is divided into two types. One is heat source, another one is heat sink. The heat source, which can supply large quantity of heat without decrease in temperature. That means what is heat source? We can continuously take heat energy from the heat source without decrease in temperature. So for example, furnace. What is a furnace? The combustion chamber of an IC engine, combustion chamber of a two-wheeler, the engine of a two-wheeler or four-wheeler, there is a combustion chamber. So what is happening inside your combustion chamber? Large amount of heat is produced. So the furnace is an example for heat source. What is heat sink? The heat sink, which can absorb large quantity of heat without increase in temperature. So we can supply any amount of heat energy to the sink. So it will absorb. It will continuously absorb without change in the temperature. For example, river, lake, sea, and the atmospheric air. So the thermal reservoir, heat reservoir, heat energy, thermal energy reservoir, it may be a heat source or a heat sink. So what is a heat source? It is continuously supplying heat energy. What is a thermal energy sink? It is continuously absorbing heat energy without much change in the temperature. So this is the thermal energy reservoir of source high temperature. So it is giving heat energy, and there is a process, various processes taking place. So the previous cycle, open cycle and closed cycle, we represent by a diagram like this. So we supply heat energy, amount of heat supplied is Q1, and there is a process, four process taking, I mean here a pump is giving the work and the turbine is producing the work. So mechanical energy reservoir, so this is mechanical energy reservoir, and this is the amount of heat given to the sink. So the this is entire cycle, cyclic heat engine, it is represented like a diagram like this. And we stop here, we take a break, and we will try to answer a few questions from your previous observation. First question, the complete conversion of low grade energy into high grade energy in a cycle is impossible. You try to answer to this question, the complete conversion of low grade energy into high grade energy in a cycle is impossible. So if your answer is true, you are correct. The efficiency of heat engine cycle is the ratio of net work done to the heat supply. I say true or false. Efficiency of heat engine cycle is the ratio of net work done to heat supply. If your answer is true, again you are correct. So define a heat source or a heat sink. So heat source, it is the body which will supply. So which will supply any quantity of heat energy without change in the temperature. Heat sink, it is the body of, it will absorb any amount of heat energy without change in the temperature. So you can write this statement, a simple sentence you can write, what is heat source, what is heat sink, so that we can refresh our knowledge from the previous slides. And continue. So the second law of thermodynamics, the statements of second law of thermodynamics, there are two statements, Kelvin Planck statement and Clausius statement, and look at here, look at this diagram. So what do you see here? HE stands for heat engine. So we have a heat engine, whether this is open cycle heat engine or closed cycle heat engine, let it be anything. A heat engine is here, and there is a source at temperature T1, the source, from this source the heat is supplied to the heat engine. The amount of heat given to the heat engine is Q1, and the heat engine is producing work. Work produced by the heat engine is W net, and the heat engine rejects heat energy to a heat sink at temperature T2. So we have the heat engine is interacting with two reservoir, one source and one sink, heat source and heat sink, and it is producing net work. So any open cycle or closed cycle heat engine, this is what happening. So heat is given to the system, heat is rejected from the system, and this work is produced by the heat engine system. So the first law of second law of thermodynamics, Kelvin Planck statements of second law. So what it says, it is impossible for any heat engine to produce net work in a complete cycle if it exchanges heat only with the bodies at a single fixed temperature. So the statement, once again, we before understanding the statement again, now look at the heat engine, and the heat engine is interacting with the two reservoir with the two different temperatures, source at temperature T1, sink at temperature T2, and it is producing the work. It is interacting with the two reservoir at two different temperature. But if it is interacting with a single reservoir and producing net work, that is not possible. That is what the Kelvin Planck statement. It is impossible for a heat engine to produce net work in a complete cycle if it exchanges heat only with the bodies at a single fixed temperature. Or you can even take the diagram, the same diagram. If T1 equal to T2, there is no net work done. If T1 equal to T2, there is no net work. That is what the Kelvin Planck statement. So the temperature, the body, the heat engine should interact with the two reservoir at two different temperature, then only the work done is possible. Look at this diagram. So perpetual motion machine of second kind. Perpetual motion machine of second kind. This is what the this is what the perpetual motion machine of second kind. What is the machine here? We have a heat source at temperature T1, and there is a heat engine. The heat engine absorbs the heat energy Q1, and it is producing net work done, right? And there is no heat rejection. Now, what is the heat engine? The heat engine interacting with a single reservoir and produces net work. There is no Q2, there is no heat sink. So, heat engine interacting with a single reservoir and work is produced. So, this is what called as perpetual motion machine of first, second kind. A heat engine will produce net work in a complete cycle by exchanging heat with only one reservoir is called as perpetual motion machine of second kind. So, now you compare the perpetual motion machine with your Kelvin Planck statement, it is violating the Kelvin Planck statement. So, this violates the Kelvin Planck statement of second law of thermodynamics, and the PMM2 is impossible. So, this is not at all possible. So, this is not possible in the real life situation. And the Clausius statement of second law, it is impossible to construct a device which operating in a cycle will produce no effect other than transfer of heat from a cooler to a hotter body. It is impossible to construct a device which is operating in a cycle will produce no effect other than transfer of heat energy from a cooler body to a hotter body. So, simply to understand, it is not possible to transfer heat energy from your cold body to a hot body, right, in a cyclic process without any effect. So, we can possibly think of this statement. The transfer of heat from your cold body to a hot body is possible with additional effect. So, that is what your refrigerator and the air conditioner. Right. So, Clausius statement, what is Clausius statement? It is impossible to construct a device which will produce no effect other than transfer of heat energy from a cold body to a hotter body. So, with some effect, we can transfer heat energy from a cooler body to a hotter body. So, Clausius statement is the basic for invention of the refrigerator, heat pump and air conditioning. So, refrigerator, we discussed the refrigerator. So, this is again a refrigerator. So, the refrigerator R, it is also interacting with the two reservoir, the heat reservoir T1 and heat reservoir T2, and this amount of heat is given to the reservoir is Q1, and amount of heat removed from this reservoir is Q2, and the refrigerator, we are supplying the work to the refrigerator. So, what is refrigerator? The temperature T2 is less. Temperature T2 is less, this is the temperature T1 is the higher. So, it is rejecting heat energy from a low temperature reservoir and supplying heat energy to a high temperature reservoir. Normally, in nature, what will happen? The heat will flow from high temperature body to a low temperature body. But here in the refrigerator, the heat is flowing from low temperature body to a high temperature body with some work input. So, we are supplying the work. So, refrigerator is a device which operating in a cycle maintain a body at a temperature lower than the temperature of the surrounding. Normally, T1 is the surrounding temperature, T2 is the temperature inside the refrigerator compartment. So, inside the food compartment of the refrigerator, you have the temperature T2 and this temperature is the atmospheric temperature. So, what is the refrigerator is doing? Refrigerator, it takes the heat energy from the food compartment and supply the heat energy to the atmosphere with some amount of work input. What is the work input here? We are supplying the electric energy to the compressor. That is what the work input to the refrigerator. And this is the layout diagram of the refrigerator. What is inside the refrigerator? So, we have a evaporator, that is a food compartment. And then we have the compressor in the refrigerator. That is what work is given to the compressor. And we have the condenser outside the refrigerator. And we have the expander or the capillary tube. And once again, we have the evaporator. So, this is what the cycle for the refrigerator, right? And the refrigerator is given by this diagram. So, we have all the four processes are given here. And it is interacting. It is removing heat energy from a body to A and supplying heat energy to the atmosphere. So, for refrigerator, instead of efficiency, we define coefficient of performance. So coefficient of performance defined as, it is given as desired effect divided by the work input. Desired effect divided by the work input. And the desired effect, what is the desired effect? What is the purpose of the refrigerator? Removing heat from a low temperature body. That is what the desired effect. So desired effect equal to Q2 divided by W. So work input is the W, Q2 is the desired effect. So this W equal to, from the first law of thermodynamics, Q1 minus Q2. So COP of the refrigerator equal to Q2 by W, which is equal to Q2 by Q1 minus Q2. And the heat pump. So the similar type of diagram, but the device is heat pump. So here again, heat pump, it is taking work from the outside and it is rejecting heat from the low temperature reservoir and supplying heat to a high temperature reservoir, right? So the heat pump is normally used in the cold countries. In the cold countries, the surrounding temperature will be very low. We want a warm room. So we want the inside of the house, inside of the room should be warm. So it is reverse of the refrigerator. So the reverse of the refrigerator is the heat pump. So heat pump is a device operating in a cycle, maintain a body at a temperature higher than the temperature of the surrounding. So the purpose is, you have to maintain the temperature T1 higher than the surrounding temperature T2. Now here, this is the room and this is the surrounding. T2 is the surrounding temperature and T1 is the room temperature. And this is what the heat pump, a similar type of diagram for the heat pump. So, and here again, we are using the refrigerant, but the purpose here is supplying heat energy to a high temperature source. So, the coefficient of performance of the heat pump is desired effect divided by the work input. So, COP of heat pump equal to Q1 by W, which is Q1 divided by Q1 minus Q2. Now, this is what the relationship between COP of the heat pump and COP of the refrigerator. So, COP of the heat pump, so this equation Q1 by W equal to Q1 by Q1 minus Q2. In the numerator, we subtract Q2 and add Q2. So, Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1 minus Q2 plus Q2 by Q1 minus Q2. So, this becomes 1 and the second term is called as COP of the refrigerator. So, COP of the heat pump is equal to 1 plus COP of the refrigerator. And we have another reflection spot here. So, state the Kelvin-Planck statement of second law of thermodynamics. So, you take few minutes, few seconds of time and write the statement. So, the statement, it is impossible to construct a device operating in a cyclic process to produce net work done with the interacting with the body at a single fixed temperature. That is what the Kelvin-Planck statement. And the classiest statement of the second law of thermodynamics, again you take few seconds and write the statement. So the statement is, it is impossible to, in a cyclic process, it is impossible to transfer heat energy from a cooler body to a hotter body without any additional effect. Define a refrigerator. So, refrigerator is a device which is which is removing heat energy from your low temperature area and supplying heat to a high temperature body with some additional work input. Define the heat pump. So, the heat pump is a device which is supplying heat energy to a high temperature body by removing heat energy from a low temperature body. And we have the another question. COP of the heat pump is always greater than COP of the refrigerator. The statement, whether this is true or false. So, if your answer is true, you are correct. So, we stop here. These are the books I have used for preparing the slides. You can also refer to it for additional information. And you can write your queries to this mail ID. I will answer to your queries. So, thank you for watching and we'll meet again.